even as early as 1991, following that hearing for his confirmation, for Thomas's confirmation, the public had begun to lose confidence in the court.
The person that we're talking to today is an author. Her name is Anita Hill. Believing, our 30-year journey to end gender violence. She is an icon. She is a woman who I would say is the mother of the Me Too movement. You know, she sat in the Senate hearing 30 years ago this week to detail what she knew of a Supreme Court justice possibility at that time. And what we learned from that hearing is that women are vilified by powers that be when you come out, and yet she's still standing. Anita Hill, 30 years later, where are we?
Well, with the issue of gender-based violence, as I explore it in Believing, we are not as far as we should be. We've made some gains. I think awareness has been raised, and it happens because of activism, student activism in part, but also organizing of advocates and organizing particularly around helping marginalized women, women, low-income women, people who are most vulnerable to achieve equity. And we've raised awareness around just the pervasiveness and the toxicity of gender violence that is experienced in people's everyday lives far, far too often.
When did you see the shift from unbelief in women who call out wrong in the workplace and in violence against women? When did you begin to see the shift after you testified in that Senate hearing?
Well, I saw it, I saw affirmation of my testimony almost immediately because I started hearing from victims and survivors of all kinds of abuse, including intimate partner violence, domestic violence. I heard from people who were incest survivors, who were rapes and sexual assault survivors. Ultimately, I think the public began to catch up. I think, you know, monumental efforts like the Me Too movement helped really solidify that. But it was a gradual process. And still we have women and people who identify as non-binary or trans, who are not believed, who are just not believed.
I can't help but think about those faces that were there in front of you 30 years ago, the late Senator Ted Kennedy, and another person who was very prominent, the current president of the United States of America, Joe Biden, the leader of the free world. And you say leadership is accountable. Was he accountable then, in your opinion, and is he accountable now?
Oh, well, I think he has become accountable for 1991. He and I have spoken. We spoke once right before he announced his candidacy. He apologized for his mismanagement, I'll say, of the hearing in 1991. But he also raised the issues of his work since then, the work on the Violence Against Women Act and on campus assault and student efforts to end campus assault and harassment. And so we had a good conversation. And what I see as his accountability now as a leader of the free world is to address the problem as it still exists. We've had the Violence Against Women Act for decades now, and yet the violence against women is still happening. So I'm really fast forwarding to now. What is the job of the president of this United States? Knowing that this problem exists in institutions throughout our country, in institutions, even his own military, what is his responsibility now? And I think it is to lead on this issue and at the very least, acknowledge it for the public crisis that it is.
At the White House, I've watched over the years when they go to deal with various issues, they get major people who are part of the issue or the issue that they're focused on for that day or that moment. you are, again, the mother of Me Too. You were the whistleblower. You were the first person to sit before Congress into detail of the way you did in front of the Senate. White men, a table of white men staring down on a Black woman who spoke profoundly about what she experienced by the then nominated Supreme Court Justice, Clarence Thomas. If indeed President Biden wanted to go to this issue and wanted to champion it, to create some kind of bill, initiative, whatever, understanding your life, what happened 30 years ago, would you stand with him for this if he were trying to champion this kind of thing?
Yeah, so I call upon him to do that. And of course I would be involved. I think any solution, any approach that he takes has to be informed by not only my experience, but by the experience of some victims and survivors who are more than willing to step up and share their stories and provide answers to some of the questions that are lingering out there and solutions that will solve some of their problems as well as the problems of others.
And lastly, this is indirectly book related and going back 30 years ago and thinking about today, January 6th, our nation saw the executive branch war upon the legislative branch. And the select committee is trying to determine so much about it. And you have Clarence Thomas, who is now the senior most Supreme Court justice, whose wife funded buses for January 6th. What does that say to you as you warn the Senate about him, but then the link, his wife, he's Supreme Court justice whose wife funded buses for January 6th. Does that bring pause or anything to you at this moment?
Well, I believe that even as early as 1991, following that hearing, for his confirmation, for Thomas's confirmation, the public had begun to lose confidence in the court. The public has lost confidence because they don't trust the way that people are selected. And that became clear again in 2018 when Christine Blasey Ford testified. So that lack of confidence is still there. And any activity by Jenny Thomas that that supports an insurrection against our country really only adds to that lack of confidence.
It just undermines the institution itself.
Yes, and that is that's something that's just one more reason that the President of the United States, who is himself a lawyer, should be acting on this issue.
Anita Hill, is there anything else you would like to add? And congratulations on this magnificent book.
Well, I would like to add that as grim as I sound about the problem, I'm just as hopeful that we can find solutions because I've seen change. I've seen energy behind this issue. I've seen the passion of survivors and victims. And I believe they deserve better. And I believe that if we invest, that we will provide better, not only for women and others who are abused today, but for people who are yet to come, the generations yet to come.